Welcome everyone to part 2 of our Godot Shaders Beginners tutorial. I'm doing a collab with Nathan from GDQuest, who has recorded part 1 of this tutorial covering 2D shaders. If you haven't seen that tutorial already, shoot on down to the link below and watch that first. I will make the assumption that you have seen his video and will not repeat some of the concepts he discusses. Nathan is creating a nice 2D animated water effect. We'll be looking at creating a similar shader but in 3D. First, here's Nathan to tell you a little more about his part of the tutorial.
Hey everyone, I'm Nathan. You may also know me as GDQuest Online because I make tutorials for Godot and other open source tools. We've teamed up with Bastian to create a series to get you started with shader programming. He's going to show you how to work on shaders in 3D. I'm focusing on the 2D part. In my series, you're going to learn how to create a 2D water shader. So I say 2D, but I invite you to go watch the series because I'm going to cover basics that Bastian is going to build upon. Shaders work kind of the same way in 2D and 3D. The syntax is the same, the functions you'll use is the same, except that you add a lot of complexity when you jump onto 3D. And there are lots of effects that are 2D in nature, working on your object's material, animating its texture, the UV coordinates. We're going to see how to do all that on the water shader, so you'll be able to apply that to 3D shader as well later. That said, I'm giving you the mic, Bastian.
For 2D, it is a little easier to demonstrate a shader effect without dressing up the scene. But for 3D, it is always nice to have an environment for our material to interact with, especially one that will end up being transparent. So I've created a very simple pool scene consisting of just a few textured planes. I've also loaded up an HDRI sky map. We won't get any benefits of that until the end of the tutorial though. We start by adding a new mesh instance node and creating a plane mesh. We're going to make this the size of our pool, and then we subdivide the mesh so we have some vertices to work with. Now we need to add a material. For our purposes today, it doesn't matter whether we create a material on the mesh or the mesh instance. I'll add it to the mesh instance. To create a material, select Shader Material from the dropdown. Click on the material to edit it and create a new shader from the shader dropdown. We will save both the shader and shader material. It is easier to access the shader this way and you can reuse it later. Our 3D shaders have a lot in common with our 2D shaders. We need to define the shader type at the top of our shader script, but in this case we define it as a spatial shader. Just like our 2D shaders, we can add a vertex function, a fragment function, and a lighting function, and they have the same purpose. For our first step, we are purely going to look at the vertex function. The vertex shader is executed for every vertex in our mesh. If we hadn't subdivided our plane, we would only have 4 vertices to play with, and we would still end up with a flat plane, just one that is skewed strangely. By subdividing our plane, we get a nice sine wave. Vertex is a built-in variable that gives us access to the position vector of the vertex we're currently processing. This is the position before our mesh is placed into the world. After our vertex function is finished, Godot will apply the transformation needed to place the vertex in the right location on screen. We have access to that transformation, but we'll leave that for an advanced shader tutorial. We are purely updating the Y component of our vector, and that results in the vertex moving either up or down. Do note that as we're updating location before our mesh is placed within the world, this will only result in the vertex moving up or down on screen if you haven't changed the orientation of the mesh. We are using the X component as the input of our sine function. Based on the size of our plane, the X value will range from -4 to 4, giving us just slightly more than one wave. Let's make this slightly more interesting by also using the Z component and changing the frequency and amplitude. Now that looks slightly more interesting. I think we should move the water line upwards ever so slightly, so we'll move our plane. Now our plane is all a uniform color. The problem we are having is that we're not adjusting the normals of the surface of our water. In order to do this, we need to calculate two helper vectors, the tangent, or the vector that lies flat with the surface of the water on the z-axis, and the binormal, also often referred to as the bitangent, or the vector that lies flat with the surface of the water in the x-axis. We can then take the cross product of these two vectors to get our normal. Taking the cross product of two vectors that both have a length of 1, a unit vector, gives us a vector that is perpendicular to those two vectors. Exactly what we need. As a bonus, Godot actually needs the tangent and binormal if you wish to apply a normal map to get more detail, which we'll do later on in our tutorial. Because we need to sample the height of our water in various locations to make this logic work, we'll add a function. Just like in GDScript, you can create your own functions in a shader. Now I realize that calculating a normal is bordering on an advanced topic, but you really can't avoid updating a normal when you change the position of the vertex. The approach I show here works well for any scenario where the new position can be calculated in a function. Don't despair, however. While we are showing how the vertex shader works, there are many shader effects where you don't need to modify the vertices at all. We can access the time that has passed using the built-in variable time. It is, however, important to realize that this variable is only accessible from within our three shader functions. For our height function, we will have to pass it as a variable. Only uniforms are globally accessible. We are going to use the time variable to animate our wave. We do this by adding a factor of time to the value we supply to our sine and cosine functions. Using a slightly different factor for our two functions gives a nice effect. I think it is time we look at adding a fragment shader. For many techniques, you'll find that the fragment shader is the most versatile. Very often, you don't need to change the vertex shader. Godot actually splits the traditional fragment shader into two parts, the fragment function and the lighting function. The fragment function is executed for every pixel we draw, and the lighting function is executed for every light that illuminates that pixel. Unless you want to do something very specific, you will rarely change the lighting function, and we won't be covering that here. Unlike our 2D shaders, we don't have a way to use default textures and normal maps in our spatial shader. We will always need to define our own uniforms for our texture inputs, and this is where we will start. We're adding a uniform of type Sampler2D. This is how we define that we want a texture map as an input. We give a hint that tells Godot that this is our albedo texture. We also add a uniform so we can adjust the scale. Then we simply assign our texture to our new uniform. After that, we'll write a very simple fragment function, which works the same as it does in the 2D shader. However, instead of assigning the built-in color variable, we assigned the built-in albedo variable. Also different is that this variable does not contain an alpha. Handling transparency is done slightly differently in 3D, as we will see in a minute. Our fragment shader has outputs for all the variables that drive our PBR shader. So our metallic, roughness, rim, clear coat, subsurface scattering, you name it. Just to show how this works, we'll add two of them. We add an output for our metallic value, and we add an output for our roughness. You can play around with these values a bit to get some silly looking reflections. Now our water is opaque. Not really how water is supposed to be, so it's time to add a little bit of transparency, and this is where you need to be a bit careful. Setting transparency is done by setting the alpha output in your fragment function. As soon as you assign the alpha output, Godot starts treating your material as a transparent material, and this has consequences. Transparent materials are always rendered last, because in order for them to work, the underlying opaque materials need to be rendered first. Also, transparent materials that overlap can come out looking weird. Instead of just setting our alpha to a single value, we're going to add a tiny bit of logic to make the white in our texture a little less transparent than the blue. Now it's time to make our water look a little less repetitive. We're going to do this in the same way as Nathan did in the 2D shader by using an offset texture. We will use this to apply an offset to our diffuse texture lookup. We need to add uniforms into our shader so we can set the texture and change the scale, speed of the animation, and how strongly our offsets are applied. Next, we go back to our material, access the shader parameters, and select the offset texture we are going to use. This is a texture where the red and green channels contain an offset that we can apply to our lookup. We need to calculate the UV coordinates that we will use to look up our offset in our offset texture. We start by taking the UV of our fragment and multiplying it by our scale. Then we use our time variable multiplied by our time scale to adjust our UV over time. We use this UV to look up our offset in our offset texture. Because we are only interested in the red and green channels, we need to select those by adding .rg. Next is a calculation you will often see in shaders. Our colors range from 0 to 1, but we need a value from minus 1 to 1. So we multiply by 2 and subtract 1. To look up our final color, we start with the UV calculation we had before, but store it into a variable. Then we add the offset we just calculated, multiplied by our amplitude setting. And then we use that as the UV in our lookup. Now we see that our water is nicely animated. Our UV distortion, however, also means that our normals are no longer correct, and again, we use the same solution as with our 2D shader. We are going to add a normal map, but there is an interesting difference. Our normal map works in conjunction with the normal of our plane. This is why it also was important that way in the beginning we calculated our tangent and binormal values. First we add a uniform for our normal map. Note the hint normal that tells Godot we are expecting a normal map, which we need to assign in our material. Note that the normal map matches the offsets in our offset map. Using our normal map is really simple. We use the same UV as we used for our offset texture to do a lookup of our normal map, and then simply assign that to the built-in variable called normal map. Now that makes a lot of difference. There is one more thing left to do, and this unfortunately is an advanced topic, but it can't be avoided to complete the effect. You get this completely free when you use the built-in spatial material. We're going to add in refraction. I'll try and explain exactly what each line in the shader does, but for the most part, it's a matter of copy-paste. We add this completely at the end of our fragment code. First, we need to know the actual normal vector where our interpolated normal from our vertex function is combined with the normal from our normal map. I have no problem admitting I stole that line of code from John. Next, we add a uniform for our refraction strength and offset our screen UV by our normal. The screen UV is a texture coordinate that is directly related to the pixel we're rendering on screen. We look up the current color that we've rendered at this position using this coordinate and a built-in texture called screen texture and apply reverse alpha to it. Then we apply our alpha to our albedo. And finally, we undo our alpha because we have already done it in our shader. Now the tiles on the walls of our pool are nicely distorted along with the movement of the water. Before we end this, a note of caution. When we use the screen texture in our shader, it triggers special behavior in Godot. Shaders that use the screen texture are rendered last, after everything else has been rendered to screen. The first material of this type that is rendered will cause Godot to make a copy of what was rendered so far into a texture, and it is that texture that is used. I hope you enjoyed these videos and learned enough about the basics of writing shaders in Godot. We'll probably do more videos diving into specific topics on how to create certain effects. If there's anything you want to know, leave us a comment and we'll do our best to answer, or may use this as an input for our next tutorial. Please give us a like. See you next time.